Welcome to Free Media, I'm Robby Soave.
And I'm Amber Duke. CNN is set to host the presidential debate between Joe Biden and Donald Trump this Thursday. Anchors Jake Tapper and Dana Bash will moderate. Meanwhile, things got a little bit testy on the network earlier this week when host Casey Hunt abruptly ended an interview after her guest, Trump spokeswoman Caroline Leavitt, started criticizing Tapper for perceived anti-Trump bias. Let's watch.
It takes someone 5 minutes to Google Jake Tapper, Donald Trump, to see that Jake Tapper has consistently frequently likened President Trump to Adolf Hitler.
Ma'am, I'm going to stop this interview if you continue to attack my colleagues. I would like to talk about Joe Biden and Donald Trump, who you work for.
Yes.
If you are here to speak on his behalf, I am willing to have this conversation.
I am stating facts that your colleagues have stated in the past.
Okay, now, as I'm for sorry, this guys. Debate, we're going to come back out to the panel. Caroline, thank you very much for your time. You are welcome to come back at any point. She is welcome.
Wow.
She sounded legitimately flustered.
What was the point of that? I mean, I think Casey Hunt ended up blowing this into a much bigger deal than if she just let Caroline Leavitt speak and, you know, was offering some criticism of Jake Tapper. You know, they end up looking like they can't take any criticism. I mean, this tactic of how many times have they shut off the camera when Trump starts to say something about the election that they don't agree with, that I don't agree with either, but, you know, they think you'll like succumb to the poison of misinformation if you get to hear it. And in this case, it was things Tapper had said about Trump that I know conservatives are not happy about, and you're not allowed to bring that up.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, CNN, I think, has the thinnest skin out of pretty much any news show or news commentary program in the history of the world. I mean, they consistently accuse Trump or other conservatives or Republicans of putting their journalists' lives in danger by calling them fake news or whatever. Right. Jake Tapper is known for sliding in the DMs of people who don't even actively criticize him, but just write articles about things he said on the air that they find like somewhat objectionable. Yeah. He's been doing that since, you know, 2016, 2017. And again, as you said, she just brought even more attention onto Jake Tapper's perceived bias by creating this blow up moment. I highly doubt anyone would have been religiously digesting Caroline Leavitt's CNN appearance if it weren't for this awkward moment of cutting her microphone and then kicking her off the program. And to do that just a few days out from the debate, where you are expected to be an objective moderator, is such a bad look.
I mean, do you think Jake Tapper's like that bad though? I don't quite
I do
understand.
Actually.
All right.
Yeah. So,
go ahead,
yes,
then.
Because I actually think that he deliberately will occasionally give a little bit of an inch to the right side to make it seem like he's being objective, but the reality is he's just as bad as everybody else on CNN. He was one of the loudest voices supporting the Russia collusion hoax, including claiming on air multiple times that the dossier was mostly verified by the FBI, which we now know it was actually Russian disinformation. He was behind partially the Trump Tower story, where they claimed that Trump knew in advance that his son was going to be meeting with Russian agents at the Trump Tower building in New York. And the sole source for that ended up being Lanny Davis, who admitted publicly that he didn't have any evidence for it. And he also has called Trump or compared Trump to Hitler numerous times over his time at CNN. So I think there's this false perception.
The rhetoric is similar to Hitler rhetoric.
What's the difference?
It's not quite the same. I mean, look, I think he... the Russiagate stuff was really bad. I mean, that's broadly characteristic of everyone in the mainstream media. I don't think it's unique to Jake Tapper. He did really good reporting on the plagiarism scandal at Harvard. CNN was one of the, actually in that case, mainstream institutions that did start pretty rapidly to cover. I mean, obviously it was the Free Beacon and Aaron Tiberium who took the lead on that to begin with, but then started covering very fairly all the Claudine Gay stuff. I've always appreciated that when I had that article, I was one of the first people to write about the Covington kids and how they had been wrongly maligned by the media. He did share my article right away, and then was flustered that CNN got so aggressively criticized still in the wake of that, because they were one of the early entities. You know, I criticize CNN all the time, but in that case, they did set it straight pretty quickly. So maybe I just have a soft spot for the guy.
Maybe, yeah. I, again, like, even if he's slightly better than the rest, I think that still doesn't reject the idea that he's biased, which I think is obvious.
Everybody's biased. That's like the annoying thing about your CNN type people, right, is they're claiming some, you know, you're entitled to your own opinion, but not your own facts or blah, blah, blah. But we're all biased people. We all have our own opinions. This kind of like pretending that there are neutral arbiters in the media, like that's an agenda in and of itself. So I definitely get that. I mean,
especially if you're going to have two people from the same network on stage as the moderators for this debate, you should be making a concerted effort to make sure that those people are at least going to have some air of objectivity, or that they represent different sides of the political spectrum.
And instead, they do not represent different sides of the political spectrum. They represent the exact same side of the political
spectrum. I mean, they're just like liberal establishment hacks, which when you're talking about a debate between Trump and Joe Biden, yeah. I mean, Trump is basically having a 3-on-1 situation. I think if anything, he's going to be having to battle the moderators just as much of it as, if not more so, than his political opponent, which is a huge problem. And this is something that's been a historical problem in the debates with Republicans and Democrats. I mean, Trump was shouted down or had his mic turned off by moderators for allegedly spreading disinformation in previous debates. I believe it was Mitt Romney when it was a Candy Crowley accused him of lying during one of the Republican debates, one of the presidential debates against Obama. So, I mean, it's just, this is a continuing theme. And for Caroline Leavitt to, again, get silenced or thrown off of the network for pointing this out is just ridiculous.
Well, so the debate rules this time around are, what they've said is that the mic is going to go off after some pre-established amount of time so that they can't, like, talk over each other or cut into each other, which is an idea that I think could make the debates better, you know, if they're just talking over each other the whole time, that would be bad. If the moderators have the power to shut off the mic before someone's done answering because they don't like the answer, that would be very, very, very bad. And then a little bit, though, if it's so timed and then it just, the mic goes off when they're done responding, then it's almost just like two interviews or just people, you know, someone saying their prearranged answer and then the other person. You know what I mean? There's a little bit of an exchange, I think, that makes it a debate.
I agree, especially when the response time is always shorter than the initial time that you get to actually answer the question. So if Joe Biden or even if Trump, let's go do it the other direction, are given 2 minutes, let's say, to respond to a moderator question, and during that 2-minute answer, they tell 6 lies or make 3 accusations against their opponent, and then the opponent gets 30 seconds to respond, and they have to tackle all of those issues at the same time, it's just impossible to obviously do that in the amount of time that you're allotted. So I think there is an argument for having some amount of crosstalk or some amount of ability to be able to challenge things in real time as your opponent is saying them.
Well, one person who will not be in the debate, even though I think a lot of people would like to hear more from him, RFK Jr., who's, you know, polling somewhere between 10, 12, 14%, you know, I've seen some as high as 16% in some states. It feels really wrong to me that he's not being included, and that's on CNN's agreement with both Biden and Trump, neither of which had any interest in extending an invitation there. They're not going by the debate commission rules, so they can do whatever they want, but it seems, you know, this isn't someone who's like 0.5% or 1%. This is above 10%. That's a significant chunk of support, and to just say, nope, not participating in this very, you know, vital tradition of our democratic electoral process. At the same time, everyone, especially in mainstream institutions, is saying democracy itself is at stake. It seems very bad to me.
Yeah, especially when CNN is creating or has accepted this rule along with Biden and Trump, that the signatures that RFK has collected to get on the ballot are not enough yet because the states have to certify them, even though he has more than enough signatures in order to get to that electoral vote threshold. And now you have New Jersey, their election commission, apparently trying to keep him from getting on the New Jersey ballot by rendering him, a sore loser rule, even though he left the Democratic Party and started running as an independent long before he would have appeared on the New Jersey ballot. It's obviously bogus.
Yeah. More free media right after this.